Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Little More Dead by Jordaina Sidney Robinson, narrated by Rachael Beresford. Chapter 1.
Bridget.
I heard the voice, but it was coming from so far, far away, and I was enjoying my day too much to listen. I was lying back on the most comfortable sun lounger I had ever known, on a blissfully deserted beach. My right arm hung off the lounger, my fingers dappling into the tantalizingly warm ocean that lapped all the way up the white sand around me. I was in Acapulco, or was it Aruba, or somewhere else that began with A? I didn't know. I didn't care. The breeze was warm enough to cool the feel of the blistering sun on my skin, but not too much to chill me. This was what heaven felt like. I had finally died properly, and this was my reward for enduring the heinousness that was the afterlife. Even real life hadn't been that bad.
Bridget.
The voice came again, more insistently this time. Maybe it was God and he wanted my attention. Maybe to utilize my awesome event planning skills to throw a party. But what type of party would they throw in heaven? And I could have sworn the voice had an Australian accent. Maybe God was Australian. Something about that struck me as wrong, but I was too comfortable to care. And not to perpetuate the stereotype, but Australians had barbecues a lot, right? How much work could they be to organise? He might be male, but surely God could manage that. He was God, after all.
Bridget.
I threw my arm over my face, my forearm covering my eyes. The voice was like a determined mosquito. Someone lifted my arm from my eyes, and the beach faded into darkness. Surely that should have been the reverse. The sun should have blinded me. It took a moment for my eyes to become accustomed to the dark. There was just enough moonlight coming through the gap in the curtains to make out a handsome, tanned face with a strong jaw covered in stubble and ocean blue-green eyes staring down at me. I squinted at him.
God, why did you turn the sun off?
Are you drunk?
God asked, heavy disapproval in his Australian-accented voice. No, I'm tired. I pulled my arm out of his grip and covered my face again. Please turn the sun back on. God lifted my arm from my face, placed it by my side and shook my shoulders gently.
Bridget.
What? 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 I snapped. Admittedly, that probably wasn't the best tone to take with an omniscient being, but he'd disappeared my sunny beach and replaced it with a dark room. That made me grumpy. I batted his hands away and sat up, rubbing my face and blinking my eyes open, my beach already only a vague memory. I yawned and looked around. Oz, my parole officer, was standing by the side of the bed, hands on his hips, frown on his face. He looked much bigger in the dark. Or maybe that was just because he was standing over me. He had the broad-shouldered physique of someone who was actively fit rather than a gym-goer. I wasn't exactly sure how I could tell the difference, but I could. I watched him watching me, groaned and flopped back down, covering my eyes with an arm again. I wasn't doubly dead. I was just plain old one-time dead. My beach had just been a beautiful dream. I was still trapped in this dismal afterlife with a job. With a nightly ghostly acclimatization meeting, with over a century of community service, with housemates like barnacles, with Oz, until I died again. You stole my
beach. I pulled the duvet over my head.
You've stolen my bed.
I spoke from under the duvet. I didn't steal it. I'm sleeping in it. Or I was. He didn't sigh exactly. It was more of a long exhalation. That was a sign he was trying very hard not to lose his temper. I was very accustomed to those signs.
Why are you sleeping in it?
Because everyone else is sleeping in mine. He pulled the duvet down from over my face.
You can't stay here.
Then get everyone out of my bed, I said, and pulled the duvet back up over my head. He pulled the duvet down again.
I thought you were getting along.
We are getting along. We'd get along a lot better, though, if they didn't climb into my bed every other night.
They just
want to be my friends, I know. What they don't understand is that friends don't have sleepovers every other night.
Okay.
Oz nodded slowly as he stepped back from the bed and folded his arms. I hated it when he did that, because it always made me focus on his biceps.
So, what do you want to do?
He asked, calling my attention away from his biceps and back to the problem. I rolled over and pulled the duvet back up. I want to get back to my dream. Which, due to Oz's interruption, was now likely to feature a hunky, scantily clad waiter that might resemble a certain parole officer. I tried very hard not to think about that, though. As my parole officer, Oz had some sort of supernatural connection to me, which meant he could sense my emotions. I called it illegal surveillance. He called it a handy tool to help gauge my adjustment.
You can't stay in here, he said.
Why?
Because it's my room.
You're letting them sleep in my room?
Yes.
Oz yanked the duvet from the bottom of the bed so I couldn't pull it back over my head and ignore him. I rolled onto my back and brought myself up on my elbows to see him staring down at me.
But this is inappropriate.
Right. Me sleeping in your empty bed is inappropriate, but me sleeping in a bed with three women is perfectly acceptable. I pointed a finger at him. You have odd standards of acceptability.
Bridget.
Look. I pushed myself upright, since it was hard to argue with any type of authority while lying down. I just want a good night's sleep, that's all. So the way I see it, you have three choices here. One, you can oust the others from my room so I can go back in there. Two, you can sleep in here as long as you promise not to get frisky. Or three, you can sleep on the sofa. Oz inclined his head in a nod.
Four, I could drag you out and dump you in the hallway.
I shook my head at him. You don't want to do that.
Why not?
I bite. Oz blew out another breath. This time he covered his eyes. Yeah, definitely holding his temper by a thread. Officer Leonard appeared behind Oz and took in the scene. He was clad in his usual black jumpsuit with black burglar mask to match. The white embroidered GB stood out in sharp contrast on both the bottom right corner of his mask and the right breast pocket of his jumpsuit. He'd combed his dark hair back, and his muddy brown eyes appeared almost black in the dim light. He was nearly as tall as Oz, but had more of an average build. I figured that all GBs had a nondescript physicality, which helped them remain unidentifiable and give the impression the ghosting busters worked as one organism, rather than individuals who could be singled out and manipulated. That said, I always managed to recognise Officer Leonard. Maybe it was his perpetual amiable smile, or maybe it was because I had more interaction with him than the average afterlife citizen. Officer Leonard folded his arms, that amiable smile a little wider than usual.
Well, isn't this inappropriate?
I pointed to Oz. That's what he said.
He's right,
Officer Leonard said without looking at Oz. I rolled my eyes. Please don't say things like that. I'll never hear the end of it.
What do you want?
Oz turned to face Officer Leonard and moved slightly to block Officer Leonard from my view. Though I think Oz's intention was to block me from Officer Leonard's view. But then, Oz was my parole officer slash guardian angel, so he could be a little overprotective slash suffocating slash downright unreasonable at times. That said, his concern was almost understandable. Not that I'd ever admit that to his face. Since a little while ago, I'd been involved in a couple of dead ghost-finding sprees. Detective Johnson, of the General Afterlife Police, had wanted to arrest me both times. But Officer Leonard had presumed my innocence. At least that's how I saw it. Oz saw it as Officer Leonard using me as bait to find the killers. Hence Oz's general disobliging attitude where Officer Leonard was concerned. I pulled the duvet all the way back up over me as I lay down and rolled over. If you're going to chat, can you please do it elsewhere? I'm trying to sleep.
I don't mean to interrupt,
Officer Leonard said, and I could hear the smile in his voice.
You're not, Bridget.
That was Oz's serious tone. I rolled over and gave Oz my best puppy dog eyes. But I'm comfy. Oz didn't say anything. He just waited. I sighed and threw the covers back. Fine, but don't expect me to be all shiny and happy in the morning. I climbed out of the bed, trying to maintain some dignity, which was difficult since the oversized t-shirt I was wearing rode up my thighs as I shuffled to the edge of the bed. And, because I was pretty sure after the duvet-tugging discussion with Oz, my bright red hair was puffed up around my head like a pom-pom. Oz's eyes narrowed on my choice of bedwear, thankfully not mentioning my case of pom-pom head.
Is that... Are you wearing your parole officer's t-shirt to bed, Miss Sway?
Officer Leonard asked. Yep. Yeah. I looked down at the faded black Rolling Stones t-shirt. It was very comfy. I could see why Oz wore them all the time.
And why are you sleeping in his bed? In his t-shirt?
Officer Leonard asked, making no attempt to hide his amusement. I shrugged. I have nothing to sleep in, or wear, really, other than my uniform. So I stole this from him. And my housemates want to sleep with me, but I don't want to sleep with them, so I'm hiding in here.
She means her three female housemates,
Oz clarified with a pointed look at me.
And they would like to stay in her room with her because they are still trying to befriend her. Is that an accurate statement?
Officer Leonard asked me. I shrugged again. Depends on your perspective, I guess.
Doesn't everything?
Officer Leonard asked and then gestured to the nearly healed bullet wound on my thigh.
That looks like it's healing well.
Oz stepped directly in front of me and blocked Officer Leonard from my vision. And again, I think it was more to do with blocking me from Officer Leonard's sight. I placed my hands on Oz's broad back and stretched up onto my tiptoes so I could peer over his shoulder at our guest. Can I get you some tea or coffee, Officer Leonard? Maybe some cake?
That's very kind, Miss Sway. But I really just need a moment with Officer Sally.
Okay, well, I'll head on up to my overcrowded bed then, I said, as I let go of Oz and moved toward the door. If you hear screaming, don't worry. I'm just murdering the trespassers.
Bridget,
Oz warned, flicking his eyes toward Officer Leonard. Officer Leonard checked his watch.
If that's really the case, Miss Sway, I'll give you an hour's head start.
I pointed to Officer Leonard but spoke to Oz. Told you he was my friend. Oz didn't say anything. He just waited for me to leave. Fine, I'm going, I said, and held up a hand in surrender as I opened the door. I closed it behind me and briefly hovered in the corridor outside. It would be wrong to eavesdrop. It would. It totally would. But then the fact that Officer Leonard had tunneled directly into Oz's room in the dead of night for a private conversation practically screamed to be eavesdropped on. Tunneling was the ghost version of transport. Homes and all bureau-related buildings were blocked to regular ghosts like me, so we could only tunnel outside the building and walk in, or to designated tunneling areas. Oz could tunnel anywhere in our house, but another parole officer couldn't, just like Oz couldn't tunnel directly into another domicile he wasn't responsible for. But when on duty, everywhere was blocked to GBs, so Officer Leonard must have had to file a flight plan and get permission. And why wouldn't he just tunnel outside and walk in? Unless he didn't want anyone to see him. But why wouldn't he want anyone to see him? I heard movement from inside the room and scurried, on my tiptoes, several steps along the corridor before the door opened again. I did my best to look casual as I turned at the sound. Officer Leonard stuck his head out and checked both ways along the corridor. "Did you change your mind about the tea?" I asked.
"No, thank you, Miss Sway. I thought I heard somebody knock," Officer Leonard said, and ducked back inside the room.
"Heard somebody knock," I scoffed quietly. I hadn't made a sound. He was checking to see if I was listening in on their conversation. Admittedly, I'd been considering eavesdropping, but now Officer Leonard had checked that I wasn't eavesdropping, totally convinced me I should be. Then again, he might have been playing me and trying to get me to eavesdrop and catch me in the act for some reason. Or maybe he genuinely didn't want me to hear what he had to say. Those GBs were tricksy at the best of times. Or at least Officer Leonard was. Before I had made up my mind whether I wanted to eavesdrop or not, Oz's door opened again, and I scurried the rest of the way along the corridor and dived into the stairwell.
"I just thought you should know."
That was the last thing Officer Leonard said before the pop of his departure echoed faintly on the corridor walls. Before I could go up to my room or down for some cake, since offering it to Officer Leonard had made me crave it, Oz stepped into the stairwell. He didn't seem all that surprised to find me there.
"Were you eavesdropping?"
"No." I shook my head, and he arched an eyebrow. "I wasn't, honest."
"Then why are you standing here?"
I was trying to decide if I wanted to eavesdrop or not. I got the impression that Officer Leonard wanted me to, so I figured I probably shouldn't.
"That's sound reasoning. I have to go out so you can sleep in my bed for tonight."
Oz raised a finger in warning.
"Tonight only. This is a one-off."
"Thank you," I said with a grateful dip of my head. "So, what's he giving you fair warning about?"
"I thought you weren't eavesdropping."
He waited until he was out in the corridor before he said it, and he made sure his voice carried.
"You don't need to worry about it, okay? Just go to bed."
Oz put his hands on my shoulders and turned me to face the archway leading to the boys' floor. "I wasn't worrying about it until you just told me not to worry about it," I said, turning all the way around, the movement forcing him to lift his hands from my shoulders. "But now you mention it, covert late-night visits from a GB do seem a touch concerning. And this honesty thing goes both ways," I said, gesturing between us. He nodded.
"Yeah, it's annoying when people just won't tell you the truth, isn't it?"
"Okay," I said, pointing to him. "I'll take that on the chin. But, if you remember, we have a deal in place where I've promised to tell you the truth, so..."
"No, you've promised to tell me the truth in exchange for something. That's bribery, not honesty."
"Why do you need to label it?" I asked, dusting some imaginary dirt from his oh-so-broad shoulder. "Why can't you think of it as a mutually beneficial arrangement?"
because it's illegal, unethical, immoral,
advantageous to us both, I finished for him. So, what did Officer Leonard want?
Look,
Oz said and placed his hands on my shoulders again, adding a softness to his voice that wasn't mirrored in his posture.
It's nothing you need to worry about, okay? Go to bed.
He tried to turn me back to face the archway to the boys' corridor, but I kept turning until I faced him and his hands dropped to his sides again. I hoped he wouldn't try to spin me around again. I was getting dizzy. If it's nothing to worry about, then why don't you tell me?
Because it's nothing for
me to worry about. I got that part. But, you know, I wouldn't worry if I knew what it was. It's uncertainty that causes anxiety. I stood and waited. Oz said nothing. The seconds ticked by. Oz still said nothing. Okay, fine. Keep your secrets. I hope you and Officer Leonard will be very happy together. Oz blinked at me, his face blank.
What?
For what it's worth, despite the whole GB thing, I think he's a nice guy. I patted Oz's bicep. I'm happy for you, really. The rest of the girls will be too. You don't need to hide this from people who care about you.
I'm glad you approve, he said, his tone flat, and pointed behind me. Now, go to bed.
He didn't wait to see if I'd go. He turned and headed downstairs. I hovered in the stairwell. Was it worth trying to pursue him and the topic? Probably not. I'd ask Sabrina, my super snooper of a best friend, what she knew about it in the morning. She was a coordinator of pre- and post-life affairs, which basically meant she was an office dog's body who filed reports all day. Handily, though, pretty much everything in the afterlife had to be documented, so she had access to heaps of information. She'd probably know more than Oz anyway. Since there was no point antagonizing him further, I turned to head back to his bed. I made it 3 steps along the corridor and stopped. I was wide awake now, and offering Officer Leonard tea and cake had settled the idea in my brain. A large dose of sugar was just what I needed to help me sleep. I turned and headed downstairs. Oz was checking the bolts on the front door as I made it to the foot of the stairs. I watched him silently. He checked them over once, rattled the door and checked them again. Just watching him raised the hairs on the back of my neck. Something about his movements told me it was more than just a repeat of his routine nightly check. Once satisfied with their security, he turned and seemed surprised to find me watching him.
I thought I'd told you to go to bed.
You did, I said, staying where I was. You also told me that I look good without makeup. Oz's frown deepened.
What?
I'm explaining why I don't listen to you. I pointed to the front door as he moved into the lounge. Why are you double-checking the locks?
I always check the locks at night.
He moved into the lounge. I followed him and watched from the lounge doorway as he checked the fastenings on the windows. Yes, but you check them before you come to bed. So this is you checking them again, after Officer Leonard's visit. Oz turned to face me, his arms out to the sides.
I'm checking the house is secure. The safety of everyone in it is my responsibility. What's your problem with that?
I narrowed my eyes at him. Is it my imagination, or are you extra touchy tonight?
I'm just trying to do my job here, Bridget, that's all,
Oz said, and there was a hardness to his expression I'd not seen before. Okay, I said, drawing the word out while I adjusted my fringe and finger-combed the rest of my pom-pom hair. I'll just leave you to it, then. I backed out of the room, since I didn't really want to turn my back on Oz at that particular moment, and headed into the kitchen. Mark and Clem, two of our housemates,
had completed their 10 years of parole and graduated into well-adjusted members of Afterlife Society, which meant they had moved out. Mark had given us a huge chocolate cake as a goodbye present. Clem had just left. I had the chocolate cake on the counter, about to cut myself a very modest slice, and then I remembered calories didn't count anymore. I felt a ridiculously huge smile spread over my face, and I cut a large slice, not quite a quarter, because I wasn't greedy, but it was close. In life, it would have taken me a week to come back from this sort of indulgence. In death, I could eat the whole thing, and my clothes would still fit me in the morning. Or they would if I'd had any. My limited wardrobe momentarily dimmed my joy, but then I forked a piece of cake into my mouth, and everything was okay again. Nearly all of my cake was gone when I felt eyes on me. I turned to find Oz leaning against the doorframe, watching me. I looked from him to my cake and back again. I gestured with my fork to the cake, asking if he would like some. Maybe he wouldn't be so grumpy with me if I shared my food with him. There really wasn't much left anyway. His lips kicked up into a small smile that didn't quite reach his eyes, and he shook his head. Something was wrong, really wrong, if cake couldn't fix it.
"I'm heading out for a while," he said, and moved across the kitchen to the back door. "Lock this behind me?"
"With the deadbolts?" I asked.
"Yep, I can tunnel directly into the kitchen, remember?"
Oz said and stepped outside. I walked over and secured the 3 deadbolts. Oz had his body turned sideways to the door so he could see the garden as well as me. A heavy unease settled in my stomach, and it had nothing to do with the pound of chocolate cake I'd just devoured. It was the way his eyes swept across the shadowed lawn, not looking for something exactly, more like checking something wasn't there. Oz turned back and gave me what I was pretty sure he thought was a reassuring smile. It wasn't.
"Everything is okay, Bridget. Don't worry," Oz said,
before he tunneled away. "You know," I wagged a finger at the empty garden, "no one ever says that unless there's something really bad that you need to be worried about." Obviously, none of the inanimate objects in the kitchen challenged that statement. So I quickly polished off the last of my cake, washed my plate, and then headed back upstairs to bed. I paused at the boys' floor and briefly considered hiding out in Oz's room for the rest of the night. But Oz's completely unreassuring smile flashed up in my memory. The tea and cake churned together in my tummy. I wouldn't be able to sleep. I was wide awake now. Maybe the sugar hadn't been the best idea after all. I carried on up the stairs. My 3 housemates would be awake. They usually required a lot of energy. They'd use up my excess sugar and have me ready for bed again in no time.
"No, the bathroom's empty,"
Petal's voice came clearly through the door.
"She's not going to be in there."
Lucy's voice was heavy with scorn. She must have been talking to Pam. She wouldn't have spoken to Petal like that. Petal could be fragile. "Why would she be hiding in her own wardrobe?"
"Don't take that tone with me, young lady."
Pam's voice sounded muffled. I assumed because she had her head stuck inside my empty wardrobe. I opened the bedroom door. Petal's head poked around the bathroom doorway, her teenage expression hopeful, and the cloud of blonde candy floss she called hair floating around her head like a halo. Pam's head popped out from inside the wardrobe. She'd tied her grey hair up in something that had once resembled a bun. Combined with her pale blue and flowery nightie, which looked more like a sundress than sleeping attire, she gave the impression she was just coming home from a stroll by the river. Lucy stood on top of my dresser, hands on hips and bare foot tapping, scowling at everyone. She'd recently had waist-length hair extensions added to her dark hair, and by the way she kept tossing her head, she hadn't quite become accustomed to the extra weight yet. "We were just looking for you." Lucy's tone made it sound like an accusation. I watched Pam step out of my wardrobe and Petal move into the bedroom. Lucy, however, made no move to step down from my dresser. "No kidding," I said.
"You have cobwebs up here," Lucy informed me.
"And you thought I'd be hiding in them?" I asked.
"No, silly. Lucy's scared," Pam said.
I looked at Lucy. She was wearing red pajama shorts and a cherry pattern t-shirt, both of which she kept adjusting as though they itched her. I glanced over to Petal, who had the sleeves and legs of her purple and green check pajamas rolled up like she was going paddling, and Pam had accessorized her nightie with a pair of green wellies. "Okay, what's going on?" I asked, folding my arms. There was drama everywhere tonight, it seemed.
"We think you have some sort of insect infestation," Pam said.
"What?" I retreated out of the room so fast I nearly tripped over myself. I didn't stop until my back was pressed against the opposite wall of the landing. I stared into the sliver of the room I could see through the doorway. I was not a fan of bugs. Except bees. I liked bees. I liked their fashionable stripes and their "don't hurt me and I won't hurt you" mentality. "What makes you think I'm infested?" I scanned the bedroom floor from the hallway.
"There's this intermittent buzzing," Pam said. "It starts and then..."
Pam stopped speaking and angled her head.
"There it is again."
Lucy squealed and stamped her feet on my dresser while Pam and Petal darted around the room, heads tilted like dogs, hearing a high-pitched whistle in an open space and trying to work out which direction it was coming from. Tentatively, I stepped forward and leaned through the doorway to listen. I sighed, in part happy I wasn't infested, in larger part unhappy at what could possibly be causing Sabrina to call me at this time. I walked into the room and across the floor to the wardrobe. It had 4 ornate feet which supported the bottom roughly 4 inches off the floor, which meant I could, on my hands and knees, reach directly under the centre of it and pull up a small section of floorboard that I'd taken a lot of sneaky time and energy to loosen. Lucy squealed as I reached inside the hole.
"Don't, Bridget! You might lose a hand."
"Wait," she said, and her tone changed. "Are you wearing one of Oz's t-shirts?"
"Uh-huh," I said, ignoring her dramatics and pulling out her mobile phone just as it stopped vibrating.
"He's never offered me one of his t-shirts to sleep in," Petal said, her voice thick with hurt at the perceived slight.
"I don't think he offered it to Bridget either."
Pam's voice almost cooed comfort.
"I think she probably stole it to make a point about her lack of clothes."
"Oh."
Petal sounded sufficiently mollified.
"Well, she does have a point, and very nice legs. Even with the scar, it gives her an air of mystery."
"Thanks, Petal." I gave her shoulder an appreciative squeeze as I moved past her to sit on the bed and check the missed calls. Since I'd managed to get myself in a bit of trouble in my first few weeks of being dead, Oz had thought it a good idea to hire an adjustment companion for me. And because said adjustment companion would just not let me have a private conversation, I'd borrowed 3 mobile phones, one each for me, Sabrina and Edith, which we topped up regularly when Edith borrowed top-up cards from supermarkets. I purposely didn't think about the repercussions when Oz found out. We'd just deal with it when it happened, and I had no doubt that, at some point, he would find out. Edith was the 3rd point in the triangle of our illegal behaviour. Sabrina and I had met her when Madame Zarina, who probably made our triangle of illegal behaviour into a square, had dragged me into her life to help her clear her name as a murder suspect. Sabrina and I had helped her, and been paying for it ever since. Madame Zarina was still alive and a medium. Edith was dead and an outlaw. Neither were company a well-adjusted dead person should have been keeping. Pretty sure that was one of the many reasons I had an adjustment companion. Pam pressed herself to the floor and angled her face, trying to peer beneath the wardrobe and inside the hole. I don't think there's anything else in there. Pam's arm snaked out and reached under the wardrobe.
No, Pam!
Lucy screeched, her hands covering her face.
No!
Such a drama queen, Pam muttered, and dipped her hand into the hole. She pulled it back out a few seconds later and pushed herself into a cross-legged position on the floor next to Petal, shaking her head. It was just a phone.
Oh!
Petal's shoulders sagged in what looked like disappointment. What's wrong with you two? I asked, Petal's dismay catching my attention. You actually wanted the house to be infected with some sort of vibrating bugs?
No.
Petal dragged the word out, implying the opposite. But it would have been a little exciting. I arched an eyebrow at Petal. A bug infestation is exciting to you. Petal nodded energetically. Bugs are fascinating. I looked to Pam, who shrugged, and then to Lucy, who rolled her eyes and shook her head in response. Are you coming down now? I asked Lucy. Now you know we're bug-free.
I'm good for the moment, Lucy said, sitting down on top of the dresser, her legs dangling over the side. Why do you have a phone?
Petal asked, climbing up next to me on the bed. Life, I said with a shrug, and called Sabrina back. At least now I could ask her to check on the reason for Officer Leonard's visit.
But we're dead, Petal said with a childlike confusion.
If someone else had made that comment, I'd have made some sarcastic remark about how shocked I was to learn that I was dead. But that would have hurt Petal's feelings, and then I'd have had to spend the night apologising. So I just patted her knee instead.
Finally!
Sabrina's exasperated tone came clearly and very loudly through the speaker on the phone. I jerked it away from my ear to turn the volume down. She was talking before I had it back to my ear.
Where have you been? I've been calling for an hour.
I was sleeping and eating cake, I said. You know, the things you normally do at night. What's up? I asked, and noticed that my housemates were inching oh so subtly closer so they could hear Sabrina's side of the conversation.
Oh, nothing really, Sabrina snapped. I was just worrying myself sick, thinking you'd been bludgeoned to death and shoved in your own locker.
Oh, that's nice. Any particular reason why?
Because that's how people kill other people here. They have no imagination. Initially, I had envisioned that you'd been shoved into a combine harvester and your remains used to fertilize a field. But then I realized that no one here has the brain power to think up that kind of body disposal, Sabrina explained.
Pam and Petal, who had been crowding around me, pulled back a little and grimaced at each other.
As lovely as that imagery was, I meant, why would I be dead? I asked.
There was a long pause on the other end of the phone. Sabrina?
Oz must know by now,
Sabrina said and left the sentence hanging. Know what? I asked. And as soon as I had, I was pretty sure I didn't actually want to know. If it required a late-night call from Sabrina, it couldn't be anything good. But I doubted she'd let me get away with pretending the connection was breaking up and just going to bed. Sabrina hesitated a moment longer, as if we were living in a sitcom and the director had told her to milk the silence for dramatic effect.
He must know that Katie has escaped.
Chapter 2. You were serious about the cake, Pam said, as she watched me get four plates from the cupboard and the large knife from the wooden block by the kettle.
Our
After the panicked screeching over Sabrina's revelation had finally ended, I'd convinced them we needed to share information, which was code for them to tell me everything they knew about Katie, since I pretty much knew nothing, and their reaction was a touch excessive for the little info I did have. All I knew was that she had been one of Oz's previous wards before she'd failed to adjust to the afterlife, had gone crazy, and then been locked away. To me, that didn't necessitate lots of panicked screaming on finding out she'd escaped. But then I didn't find bugs fascinating either. Even with all the screaming and Sabrina's call, I still wouldn't have been all that concerned about Katie's escape. Except Officer Leonard had considered her dangerous enough to pay a late-night visit to Oz. At least that's what I was assuming the visit had been about. Then again, Oz had gone out and left us alone in the house, so we must have been pretty safe. So, was Katie dangerous or not? Something about this situation just wasn't adding all the way up. If Sabrina hadn't stressed how crazy people always return home to murder everyone they used to know, I'd probably have just gone to bed. I seriously doubted Sabrina was right about Katie coming back to murder us all. I figured she had some sort of plan to find Katie and was just trying to goad me into some more illegal behaviour. But after Sabrina had painted an overly gruesome picture of me, waking up amongst the dismembered limbs of my housemates, I just couldn't go back to sleep.
"There's never a wrong time for cake," Petal said, as she climbed onto a stool at the breakfast bar and began swinging her legs while she waited. "Thank you."
I waved my large knife in the air as I placed the plates on the center island next to the cake. "Finally, someone who gets me."
"I think I'll take that."
Pam slid from her stool and removed the knife from my hand. She positioned it over the cake, ready to cut what looked, to me, like a slither. You wouldn't even get a proper taste of it from that. I couldn't bear to watch, so I left them to it and returned to my tea making. And then I had to glance back in morbid fascination to see if she really was going to cut the tiniest slice.
"Do you mind if Bridget cuts my piece?" Petal asked, just as Pam pressed the knife into the chocolate frosting.
"Why?"
Pam asked, in a tone that said she did mind. Lucy settled herself onto the stool next to Petal.
"You cut healthy slices of cake, whereas Bridget cuts healthy slices of cake."
Pam pointed the knife at Lucy.
"You mean slabs."
I placed the four mugs of tea on the island countertop and slid the knife from Pam's hand. "I think I'll take that." Once everyone had their tea and slab of cake, I got right to the point. I didn't feel subtlety was necessary. Everyone had tea and cake, after all.
"So, what's the big deal about Katie?"
All three of them choked. I watched them all struggle for air and slap each other on the back. I would remember this for future. Apparently, tea and cake did not negate the need for subtlety.
"I don't want to talk about Katie," Petal said,
when everyone had got their breath back. She jabbed at her cake with her fork, tears already brimming in her eyes. I handed her a tissue. I was ready for the tears, and I was not letting them deter me.
"We're going to have to."
I gave Petal's hand a squeeze. She seemed to find those types of gestures reassuring. Apart from the occasional hug I got from Sabrina when my afterlife was in danger, which was usually on any day that ended in Y, I wasn't really up on the touchy-feely stuff. I actually found being touched quite offensive, so it confused me when other people were happy about it, even welcomed it. Petal glanced up at me with wide, watery blue eyes.
"Okay."
Before I knew what I was doing, I climbed off my stool and quickly put my arms around Petal, only super quick. The contact lasted less than a second. I pulled back, more in shock that I'd done it than anything else. I had no idea what had come over me. It must have been the sugar. Too much sugar can make people act strange. Petal smiled at me as I sat back down, and it was like the sun was shining out of her face.
I told you we just needed to wear her down.
Petal wiggled happily in her seat in a similar fashion to Sabrina when she was overexcited. Though Sabrina was usually excited about murders and law-breaking, not hugs. Lucy shook her head at me in disgust. Being dead has changed you. You used to be mean. Yeah, I said. There's nothing like nearly being murdered every day of your afterlife to change your perspective. I'd been dead nearly 3 weeks, and pretty much for the first fortnight, I'd found a dead body every other day. Most of the time, they'd been stuffed in my locker and stained my work uniforms, but now I had a new locker that only Sabrina knew about. Hopefully that meant no more stained uniforms and no more being a murder suspect. Suppose. Lucy inclined her head, her curtain of dark hair extensions falling forward over her shoulder. She heaved them back and out of her way in annoyance. I just liked mean you better. Yeah, me too, I nodded, though I wasn't actually sure if that was true. Now, tell me everything you know about Katie. What's the big deal? What was all the screaming? Didn't Oz tell you? Pam asked. Oz told me she failed her assessment and was sent to a readjustment centre. She failed that process too, which I didn't think was possible, and is now classed as a poltergeist, a ghost serial killer. I paused and thought about that for a moment. And now I'm saying it out loud, it seems like an odd leap to make. You fail a couple of assessments and you're branded a serial killer. I assumed he meant potential serial killer, but that wasn't what he said, which is weird. He also made me promise not to talk to any of you about it, because he said you'd all get upset. But now I'm getting the feeling there was an ulterior motive. I looked around the table at the shifty expressions. Is that what happened? If that's what Oz told you. Pam shrugged and let the sentence trail off, still not meeting my eyes. I looked around the counter. Nobody would meet my eyes. Oh, come on, guys. Give me something. She tried to kill Petal, Lucy said in a matter-of-fact tone, usually reserved for stating something innocuous, like the fact it was going to rain tomorrow. I blinked, as if that would somehow help my brain process that comment faster. I'm sorry, Lucy. What did you say? I blinked again. It still didn't help with the brain processing speed. I looked between the three of them, waiting for someone to say, "Gotcha." Nobody did. I opened my mouth to speak, but it took several seconds for the words to actually find their way out. She tried to murder you. She tried to murder Petal. Are you serious right now? A flurry of tears rolled over Petal's cheeks, as if it were a race and they were all desperate to win. No. I gestured for Pam to sit back down when she moved to comfort Petal. Petal, you tell me right this second what happened. Pam hesitated and then climbed down off her stool and reached for Petal again. She's upset. I pointed to Pam's vacant seat. Pam, sit back down. Petal, explain that last comment. Cry if you need to, but explain. I handed her a tissue and waited. I think mean Bridget is back, Lucy mumbled. I didn't respond. I gave her my best quelling look. One, in my old life as an event planner, I usually reserved for bridezillas who were getting on my last nerve. Lucy looked back down at her untouched cake. Yep, she's definitely back. You did say you liked her better, Pam mumbled, as she hopped back up onto her stool with more agility than I'd ever known. Pam reached across the counter and patted Petal's hand, giving her an encouraging nod. Tell Bridget what happened. Petal swiped at her tear-crowded cheek.
I was in Katie's room, waiting for her to get home. She'd only just scraped through her adjustment assessment, and it was the end of her first week back at work.
Oz told me she'd failed her assessment. I looked around at the three faces. Again, not one would meet my eyes. Right, so he lied. I'm sorry to interrupt, Petal. Carry on.
I wanted her to have a happy face to come home to. I was waiting a while, so I thought I'd be helpful and rearrange all her lipsticks for her. They were all red, but slightly different shades. I was trying to put them in an order for her, like light to dark. I thought that would be helpful. But she was upset when she found me in there. She said some really mean things to me. And I told her it was okay and that I knew she didn't mean it, and then...
Petal pressed the back of her hand to her mouth to cover a sob, and Pam was once again up and out of her seat. I didn't say anything. I just snapped my fingers and pointed back at her stool. Pam paused, scowled at me, but sat back down.
And then what, Petal? I asked.
Petal swiped at her tears. She looked up at me, her eyes red and swollen. It was all I could do not to wince at the sight. See, this is why I was reluctant to cry. Yeah, you might get your own way in an argument, but it took so long for the puffiness around the eyes to lessen.
And then she tried to strangle me.
She tried to strangle you? I dropped my fork. The clatter as it hit my plate was the only sound around the kitchen. I'd assumed the whole "she tried to murder Petal" thing had been an exaggeration, and Katie had just thrown a cup at Petal or shoved her really hard, and Petal had tripped down the last three stairs or something. Not a "she wrapped her hands around my neck and tried to choke the afterlife out of me" type deal. Petal shook her head quickly.
She wasn't trying to kill me or anything. Katie was a nice person. I think she was just tired, and I was talking too much. I was messing with her makeup. It was really my fault. I felt so bad when Oz sent her away.
I got up from my seat and grabbed the chopping board, a clean knife, and the cucumber from the fridge. Okay, Petal, this is not your fault. It's the fault of the crazy person who tried to strangle you. I cut several slices and put them on a plate before returning the cucumber back to the fridge.
Petal shook her head. No, it was. If...
Be quiet, I said, pointing the knife at her before tossing it in the sink with the chopping board. I can learn to tolerate your eternal peppiness, your fondness of hugs, your unwavering enthusiasm, your reciting dialogue from films, your perpetual happiness, yada, yada, yada. However, I absolutely will not tolerate you assuming blame for the actions of other people. Do you understand me? Everyone must be held accountable for their own actions. I mean, do you hear me whining about my community service?
You do whine about it a bit, Lucy said quietly.
Maybe to you, Pam mumbled. She whines about it a lot to me.
Actually, she whines about it a lot to me too, but I didn't want to undermine her because she was sort of making a good point, Lucy mumbled back.
Hey! I slapped the cucumber plate on the tabletop to get everyone's attention. The point here, Petal, is that if someone, anyone, wraps their hands around your throat, you have numerous options. You can beat the afterlife out of them until they take their unwelcome hands off you. If you can't do that, then you scream for us, and we'll beat the afterlife out of them. If you're not happy with either of those choices, you could, of course, call Oz or the police, or even the GBs. But there is absolutely no option here for you to blame yourself. Am I clear?
Petal jumped off her stool and threw her arms around me, and hugged me so tightly I was sure I felt a rib crack. I love you, Bridget.
I patted her back. I love you too. Now get off me.
Petal sat back in her seat and munching caught my attention.
What are you doing? I asked Pam. Pam looked down at her cucumber-topped chocolate cake.
What?
Why is there cucumber on top of your cake?
I thought you'd cut them to make our cake healthier.
Pam looked from me to her cake and then back again.
Didn't you?
I stared at Pam, thinking she was joking. She wasn't. They were to reduce the puffiness and soothe her eyes, I said, pointing to Petal's face.
Oh.
Pam bit her lip and pulled a slice of cucumber from her cake, one side smothered in chocolate frosting, and handed it to Petal.
Sorry.
What world did you people live in before you died? I asked in horror, as Petal licked the chocolate frosting off the cucumber slice before placing it over her left eye. How do you not know this stuff? Pam shrugged, pulled off a second piece of cucumber, licked the frosting off and then handed it to Petal.
Do not put that on your face, I said, taking it from her hand and dropping it back on the plate.
I plucked the other slice from her eye. It had left an almost perfect ring of chocolate from the edge of the cucumber slice. I looked at my three housemates. Petal, with her chocolate eye ring, happily eating her cake. Pam, hungrily staring at the sliced cucumber. And Lucy, trying to sneak a chunk of Pam's cake while she wasn't looking, despite still having plenty of her own left. These were my housemates. I adjusted my fringe and wondered if this was what being a parent was like. I was sure I never gave my mam this much trouble. Okay, so Katie attempted to strangle Petal, but she didn't actually kill anyone, I asked.
Oh no, she killed a whole heap of people.
Lucy gestured to me with a fork heaped with cake. She started with her best friend, then a couple of people from her GA group, then some messenger guy, and then...
Pam shook her head. No, the messenger guy was a rumour.
No, she totally killed him,
Lucy corrected.
Petal shook her head. I thought it was...
Hey!
I slapped the countertop to get their attention. What? Lucy asked, before shoveling some more cake in her mouth.
How many people did she kill?
I asked. 9, said Lucy.
1, said Petal.
3.5, the half being Petal, Pam explained. 9 was a rumour, and Petal's trying to be nice.
I exhaled slowly, regaining my patience. Finally, a straight answer. Not an answer I particularly wanted, but beggars couldn't be choosy.
How did they catch her?
Lucy pointed her fork at me.
That detective that's always trying to arrest you for something caught her.
Oz said they'd suspected her of the other 3 murders, but didn't have enough proof until she tried to kill Petal, Pam added.
And Oz just let her continue living here when the police suspected her of murdering people, I asked.
He lets you live here, Pam pointed out.
I thought about that for a moment and then nodded.
Touché.
But how was her attacking Petal proof of the other murders?
We're not detectives, Lucy said. And have you tried to get information out of Oz that he doesn't want to tell you?
I nodded.
Once again, touché.
Before I could try to extract any other nuggets of information, the phone vibrated on the counter. I checked the text and moved to peer out of the kitchen window at the long garden. There was definite movement by the weeping willow tree at the far end.
Sabrina's here.
I moved to unlock the bolts from the back door. On discovering a homicidal crazy person who used to live in our house had escaped, and after watching Oz double-check all the window and door locks, and after Sabrina's colourful imagery of our gruesome demises, I thought it wise to have some way to defend ourselves, so I'd asked Sabrina to bring over some of the non-lethal kind of self-defense stuff. Lucy darted over to the door and grabbed my wrists before I could open it.
Are you sure it's her?
I jerked my head in the direction of the tree, since Lucy had my hands accounted for.
Well, there's a figure where she said she was waiting, so yeah.
That might be Katie.
Pam shuffled behind Lucy, adding another layer of human barricade to the doorway.
Okay, let's not get overexcited, I said, extricating my wrists from Lucy's hold.
I placed my hands on Pam's upper arms and shuffled her to the side.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.